Hey guys, what's up? Misha from GGD here, and today I'm going to be showing you a little mix walkthrough that I did using the new GGD P5 library, and we're going to be looking at a song from P5. Let's look at Dracul Gras. I'm just going to refer to this song as Fat Drac from now on. That's always been the name. I don't know why we changed it. It's just Fat Drac. We all accept. Joe, what is this song called? Tell me.
Well, I mean, on the album, it's cool.
Thanks, Joe. Anyways, let's listen to this. Before we listen to this, real quick, this is kind of fun because obviously this was on P5, so it was performed by Matt. But as is traditionally done when we're demoing everything, I program the drums using GGD, obviously. I think I used my Franken kit, which was, you know, kind of mainly a combination of P4 Invasion and Modern and Massive, I think. But yeah, like P4 was kind of the basis of that kit. So I programmed everything with that. We wrote everything here. Then Matt played it, sampled the kit, and now I'm using the MIDI from the demo session with the P5 kit. So that has come full circle in a nice way. The MIDI plays very, very nice with it. It only required like a couple little velocity tweaks. But yeah, I'm using this kit. I'm using the low snare. If you watch the other walkthrough, I don't know if this one's coming out first or the other one's coming out first, but the other walkthrough where I did Ultimatum, I did not use any turbo. This has some turbo, has some reverb being used. This is using a bit of the internal processing. It's still multi-out, and there's quite a bit of processing happening within the mix as well. We're, you know, going to a nice healthy master bus as well. We'll look at all that, but let's listen to this little clip first. And yeah, the rest of the audio is using the stems from our producer pack. Periphery sells a producer pack with stems. So, you know, we've got Nolly's bass track, the rhythm guitars, and the synths. Not what you were expecting, huh? Kind of works together. We're just doing the end of this. This has the most interesting MIDI. I kind of programmed, not a drum solo, but like it's like where Matt kind of gets to go a little bit crazier than he normally would using this section that comes back. And it's funny because, you know, just talking from a programming standpoint, I threw these fills in, you know, these little things, and I like them. But sometimes Matt will go in the studio and just kind of do his own thing. But I guess he liked what I wouldn't mind if he wanted to do a couple takes where he just does his own thing. You know, he's so creative and so musical. He gets it. Like, we really speak the same language when it comes to collaborating and drumming. And there's sometimes where I just don't even bother programming. I'm just like, just do your thing. It'll be better than anything I program. In this case, I threw some stuff out. I was like, oh, this sounds pretty cool. But I guess he liked it because he pretty much mirrored it. If you listen to the album, he like really like, it's kind of impressive how he just nailed some of these parts. That's all like pretty much exactly as I programmed it or close enough. So it kind of shows you the fun. It shows, you know, we always get this question. I'm going to answer it now. I'm sure you guys have heard this answer before, but why do you program drums or why are program drums useful? And, you know, in the case of where you have someone like Matt and Ollie in an amazing room and great engineering and mixing and all that stuff going on. Sure, like go to that room, go spend the money, go get it done right. You're going to end up with a great result. I think the drums on P5 sound incredible. But if you don't have that, it'll probably fall short. And I think program drums sound amazing when they're good samples, such as what we offer, and when they're sort of processed and treated well and programmed well. So you can get a really good result. You can do a lot of hyper real stuff. We'll get into some of that stuff as we mix. But you know, this is good enough for a final product, in my opinion. It's just, we had the tools, to get something new, something unique. And then of course we sampled the kit at the end. We were so happy with the drums on P5. So I was super excited to get this kit. This one features the lower tune snare again. It's Matt's, signature snare drum. I think it just sounds so killer. You know, it's this has been something you guys have to understand, that when we're trying to get drum tones, and anyone here who's gone to the studio, for all the planning, for all the work you put in on the front end, you never quite know what's going to come out on the other side. It's just as it happens. Maybe there's a bit of magic, but you know, there's so many variables: the room, the equipment that's there, the vibe. Like, oh God, there's so many elements that go into it, and you try to control all these elements, but ultimately, the drums will take on a life of their own, and they'll come out as they come out, and that's sort of the backbone of the mix, and that will determine what the mix sounds like. And I just felt so lucky with this because we got so many things to work. So the low snare, I love a good low snare. I mean, I actually love like snares with a lot of crack. I tend to like mid and higher tuned snares because you get the most crack out of them, the most pop out of them. They just sound really intense. And it's really, really hard, in my opinion, to make a lower tuned snare cut through and sound big, you know, without resorting to one shots where they sound like low tune one shots. You'll hear that in a lot of modern music. It's a cool sound, but it doesn't necessarily sound like a drummer hitting a drum very hard. And I just feel like low tuned drums, it's you try as hard as you can, but sometimes it's luck of the draw. Matt's Pearl signature snare, by the way, is incredible. And this is just a testament in all tunings how good it sounds. But it's really the fact that it can work so well as a low tuning and still just cut through the mix. So yeah, I was excited to sort of recreate that again using the original demo MIDI, but using the low tune snare for this demo. And as you can see, you know, we have a little bit of processing. What's nice about this is that you can actually, you know, I have these linked, but you can process each one of these channels individually. And you can see I have like varying amounts here. They're not always the same, but you know, you just do this based off flavor. I've got the envelope here going on the toms, and you can actually hear that there. And what that's doing is actually just getting these are sampled very, very properly. So you're getting a lot of the ring. But we don't really need that, so I'm just cutting some of the decay out of it, basically. And you can hear there, it's like sort of artificially cut off, but it works really well. It's a very tom-heavy section, and what can happen is that it could get very overwhelming with the low mids. We also have, like, you know, processing going on all this stuff here. Again, anywhere you see this line, that's the amount of turbo. And that's the turbo is the internal processing. It's been dialed in by Nolly. It's really, really good. And you want it fully processed, well, just turn it all the way up, or use one of the turbo presets that's processed Or if you want to do it yourself, you know, and if you watch the other, again, I don't know if this one comes out first or second, but I did another one where there's no processing for ultimatum, then you can do more work in the box or have a more natural sound. It's really up to you. But with this one, we're doing kind of a hybrid thing, so there's a bit of processing happening in here. And then let's look at what I'm doing here. This is actually pretty similar, for the most part. It's slightly a bit more natural, slightly more natural. Again, we are going into a master bus, which is just the way that I approach this. But oops, sorry, we don't need the color palette, do we? So really, and here we could shut these off. We don't need that either because we are not monitoring anything right now. Let's start with the kick as always. So again, we can run this. A lot of this is gonna be similar to the ultimatum video, and I'm just gonna assume that this comes out second, or Joe. This means this one comes out second because I go very in depth on that. But a lot of this is the same. But again, smash and grab on absolutely everything. Now, there's kind of an interesting quirk here, which you're hearing, which is, and this is kind of a limitation of contact. It's not really affecting too much because ultimately it sounds good, but the reverb is forced to the channel. There is a way around this where I could create another channel, but because I'm using the default multi-out, everything is sort of set up so that the outs here sort of correspond. They increase incrementally, and I just name them appropriately. It's the easiest way to set this up. So if I eliminate the reverb, then it's gone. It's just in that first channel. Again, there's a way around this just for simplicity and getting this done. And it sounded good, and that's what matters. I don't care. It's working well for me. We'll eliminate it for now just so it doesn't get distracting. It's really just on the snare. But it's coming through the kick channel, which has a ton of processing. So if we take all that off, smash and grab, getting about 3 to 6, and we're doing the grabby one. We're getting a bit more of a transient here, and this time we are no, we're still using the clicky kick there. Q2, we are eliminating all that gunk. You hear that, right? Just cleaning up some of the clicky frequencies there. Our bass, where would I be without you? Just getting a bit of that sub in there. Just it, you know, this is the little stuff that adds up that in the mix will help the kick have weight, in my opinion. Saturation, because you can never have too much saturation. Trusty old decapitator. I guess normally I like end mode, but like A seems to be less clicky. Maybe I went for that reason. And this stuff gets dialed in and tweaked in the mix. And then we have the transient designer, the SPL transient designer. Really like it. It just kind of does the job very, very well. Very easy to set. Just getting a little bit of attack, taking on a bit of sustain. If you guys aren't using transient designers on your, well, anything with transients really, but your shells, you're kind of missing out. I mean, it's a compressor that's sort of dialed to enhance the pokiness or reduce it or increase the sustain. And it takes the guesswork out of doing that. It's kind of a purpose-built compressor to do that. But they're referred to as transient designers because you're kind of messing with the transients mostly. And then what do we have here? Oh. Ermin Hamidovich's favorite plugin in the world. Again, these tend to end a little bit of low mid mud and some saturation, some light saturation. I just like the way they sound on kicks. They really round them out. You really like chop those transients off after we added them in. Then what do we have here? Oh, adding some. I guess this is one of those ones I must have dialed in just in the mix, just being like, this is what it needs. But, you know, it's just kind of like broad brush stroke. A lot of 350, which isn't like a frequency I'd normally try to boost. And this must be for the click. Again, not much going on. Kind of taming this down there, a little bit of the sub down there. And yeah, like, you know. And again, you know, we'll touch on this maybe now, but this is going to a parallel compression bus, which we can could detail later what's going on there. Onto the snare, which also has a ton of plugins here. Again, smash and grab. So we take everything off. Even with nothing on, it still sounds pretty good, right? It's just softer. But yeah, it's all little, just little moves that go a long way. So again, we're doing the grabby mode. So again, this will be less intense than the FET mode. It'll preserve more of the transient, so you get a bit more of a pokey snare. We've got Q2. This Q2 must be the same one I've had for years now, and I just keep just resetting it or adjusting it, because it should be Q3 by now. But again, just, you know, this is very much just designed to... Can hear all those ghost notes there. Actually, let's get rid of the parallel compression. Very small moves, just cleaning it up a little bit. What do we have here? Getting rid of the 500 gunk. It's just very boxy frequency that. It takes up a lot of space. It fights with a lot of... There's a lot of stuff happening in 500. So you kind of want to get rid of that more than you think. Around 3,000, I guess we're... Yeah, just a little bit of that clickiness out of there. And there's a slight shelf, because we always want a little bit more top end if we can manage it. This is another saturator. But I like what this one's doing for the sustain. And then just cranking through this, because we have a lot to go through. And then this is just more saturation. More saturation. Can never have too much saturation. Without. With. So it's this is helping both the transients and the sustain a little bit. And then more attack. Love smack attack. It's all just about slightly shaping it. Probably could be done in a lot less moves, but I am dumb. And then on to the toms, which again, we have these in smash mode. Oh yeah, there's like a lot of toms at the end here. This would be perfect. These aren't really like hitting full velocity. It sounds like drums falling down the stairs, doesn't it? There. I just think, I mean, you guys can hear, maybe you agree, disagree, but I just think these toms sound so good. We should feed this to the parallel compressor. Let's get a little bit. Might be a bit much, but whatever. We'll deal with that later. Q3. Just tidying it up a little bit there. And and here we're using the soft tube tape, which I like. Let's look how fancy this looks. Just can never have too much tape. Should I just get reel to reel? Should I get a reel to reel? Should I get one? Like, as I've convinced myself, I want a reel to reel. I want one that's like more lo-fi to process stuff. What should I get for that? And should I get like a super high-end one to like record to, just for tape vibe? I don't know. Ermin will be so stoked. Nolly will think I'm wasting my money, and I will be very happy. moving on, moving right along. So again, we are going for something kind of hyper real, but here you got the kick compared to the other one. You remember what I said? If you watch the other one, I was like, the overheads really could show a good picture of sort of how realistic a kit can sound. Like I said, like, I feel like the overhead always sounds very, like, if you have it programmed well, it just always, that's the one that sounds like a drummer playing. So I like to have a lot of that. Helps with, well, especially if you're going for a natural vibe, right? I think that always helps. I really just love the way the overhead sounds. I know I'm just gushing about this kid. I'm sorry, guys. But I'm genuinely just so happy. And you know what? We've seen the feedback that you guys have given. It seems like you guys like it too. Let me know in the comments. I would love to know what you think of this kit. But I genuinely feel like this is a new standard. This is a new standard. I was trying to say standard and benchmark at the same time. Standmark. This is a new standmark for us. And yeah, I want all our new kits to be at this level of detail and just quality and just character, vibe, excitement. Just so happy with it. And again, all the processing, I know you're seeing a lot of processing. It's all very minimal because we're not trying to fix anything. We're trying to have things play nice and we're just trying to enhance things slightly. So, you know, here we got. This is actually a pretty big change. I'm crushing these overheads. I didn't realize that. I kind of dig it though. I wouldn't normally crush the overheads that much, but kind of like it. Sounds good. Ah, I love what it's doing for the snare. And that's the thing. I will EQ. Let's see what's going on. So I'm trying to have this not fight too much. Like let's hear in the mix. Actually, I'm curious. Maybe we're cutting a little too much here, actually. Because I like what it's doing for the top end. We do need that sort of brilliance. We're in the ballpark there. I like the overheads to help out with the snare and the shells. I really do. And sometimes you may not realize how much of the heavy lifting it's doing for the snare sound. It's kind of that the overheads, the room, and the snare mics and the parallel compression all working together. It's not just the snare channel, because you might hear the snare channel, you're like, that's cool, it's a cool character, but it's not got the weight. But you get it from all those things coming together nicely, right? Let's see what we're doing with the rooms. We're doing my double smashed rooms, you know, so without anything, it's so quiet. So, got some output coming out here, but just crushing this. But you can do that stuff because, like I mentioned in the other video, I take a lot of the cymbals out. In real life, you can't do that, but I can do it here because you have control over every channel. So, like when you go to your, let's say your cymbals. We're just keeping these. You can keep them all the way out. Again, I like a little bit, just a tiny little bit, just to play nice. But yeah, like if you had all those cymbals in there, it would not be very happy with all that compression. But because we have barely any cymbals in there, you can crank it and really hear the sustain of the room. You can really make use of that sustain in the room, and I like that. Parallel compression. We have got this is the same setup as before. Crushing it in parallel mode, EQing it a little bit here, getting rid of some of that mid-range mess there, and then doing another pass with a grab mode. And parallel compression can be overly compressed. It really can. I mean, I'm feeding like more cymbals than I think, you know. Just a little bit. A lot of room is going there. But yeah, like this just, you know, it gives it the sustain, gives it the character, gives it the compression without it being overbearing. So let's bring the slider down and bring it back up to taste. That seems is about right. And again, we are doing the same reverb trick. I'm digging this because it's this short sort of artificial thing. It's the reverb doesn't need to be long. It just needs to be present for a little bit, right? So that's without it. And that's with it. So in the mix, just sort of cuts through, blooms through. That's for like the sort of sustain. It's not for the attack of the snare. It's so that everything else can also cut through and you don't end up with this kind of papery sounding snare. But yeah, that covers it. On this one, I've got nothing on the drum box. It's late. The drum bus. I have nothing on the drum bus. I always mess with this, but sounds good. It's very compressed. Very, very compressed. And that could be good for certain vibes. It's not good for others. I like where we're at. It's powerful, but kind of natural sounding. It's not over compressed. So it's all playing very nice. And then let's see what's going on this good old tubus. So again, we have our first serve, our safety serve of the EQ here. Just kind of, you know, cut out the sub we don't need at the bottom. A little boosty boost around 100. Cut out the 500 gunk mess. And then, you know, boost the top because we always want a bit more brightness. Got the SSL set up the same way. I've got it. You know, ratio 4, threshold to taste. We are high passing. I know this is 74. It's just set, like I said, it by ear or by gain reduction, just by seeing when it's kind of avoiding the kick. And we're going for a really fast attack, really fast release. And the main goal for this, other than getting that SSL bus glue sound, is that really getting it to focus on gain reduction for the snare. So you see that? So it's really just reducing about 3 dB every time the snare hits, which allows you to basically have the snare punch through. It's kind of a clever way of doing that. Then we've got this mid-side thing that I detailed in the other video, Nolly's secret EQ, the left and right EQ. All this is detailed in the other video, so watch that. We've got this dangerous This EQ on the master bus, which I think is kind of cool. We've got Pro L dialed to taste. I've got this meter here, which is just telling me about this. Oh, we are way too loud, aren't we? But it sounds good, so who cares? Plus, I don't actually know which meter is correct because this is saying it's minus 10, this is saying minus 8, minus 7. So, you know, it's who knows? It's just, who cares? I don't care about loudness. I just want it to sound good. But there you go. You have all the secret sauce. You have all the settings. Just copy everything I did if you like the sound. And then make it better, because you probably can. Because you are likely more talented than I am when it comes to this stuff. But this is a very good starting point. And hopefully if you got the kit and you want to know how to process it and maybe some tricks, well, hopefully you learned a thing or two by watching this. I also I've decided that I have the Ultimatum demo mix walkthrough out first, because Joe wouldn't let me down. Joe, don't do me dirty on this, so that all those references, they can be references. You know what I'm saying? With all that said, I really hope that you enjoyed the video. Let me know what kind of videos you'd like to see me do more of in the future, and I will do my best to do them. Until then, I will see you.